So chapter 63, for example, which covers textile articles, shows the same trend. And you will see it all throughout the harmonized schedule, where you have 8 digits and a duty. 8 digits and a duty. So what about the other ones? What about the 9 and 10? 9 and 10 is really called a statistical suffix. And you can see that over here. Statistical suffix, right? And statistical suffix is really up to the United States to adopt. And the United States adopts it primarily to distinguish certain classes of merchandise which are important to its economy, not to, as opposed to economy of others. I was doing a project using the Canadian tariff schedule, and it's interesting to see that the 6 digits they're all the same, but when it goes down to the to further, you have things such as special provision for religious bells and gongs, for example. You have you can see that the more religious imprint left within the Canadian tariff schedule than the U.S. tariff schedule, probably because of the country's history. So, going back, based on this, we can tell that the 9th and 10th digits are the statistical suffix. And but let's not stop there. Let's take a look at others. Let's take a look at others, because most of the time, if you recall the question and answer methodologies, you will be faced with a situation where you have to engage in process of elimination. If you know that this is true, yes, great. But what if you're not sure? What if there are other equally good answers? Is it a best answer? Remember the best answer rule in the customs broker exam. And so given that you have enough time, it may be worth the inquiry of looking at others. So B says the digits, the 9th and 10th, are optional on all formal and informal entry summaries. No. If you're going to classify and the number is 10 digits, 10-digit tariff number, the digits are not optional. The only the way they can be optional if there is, for example, informal entry, and but it's a special type of entry, such as entry under section 3-1 of the Tariff Act of the United States, section 3-1, section 3-1, and this is informal type of entry for the products which are $200 or less. $200. If you're doing this entry, it's duty free. Congress said it's duty free just because it's just a small amount. So, and because it's duty free, there is no reason to bother with the HTSUS, because the primary purpose of the harmonized tariff schedule is to determine the duty. Of course, if it's more than 200, then you, even irrespective of whether formal or informal, you have to classify this, meaning assign the harmonized tariff schedule number. Looking at the C, the digits affect the duty rate applicable to the entered merchandise. No, because remember what we saw with our preview. The duties are really done at what? At the 8-digit level, right? Not at this level. At this level, it's already done deal. It's, for example, in this situation, it's 11.9%. In this situation, it's 6%. Irrespective, it's a pillowcase, sheets, or other, right? Most important, it's a bed lining. It's knitted or crocheted and made out of cotton, for example. Next on the list is D. The digits are governed by the international rules under the harmonized system and cannot be changed without the unanimous consent of all signatory countries of the harmonized system. Well, this means this means that because customs examiners ask you about this, you have to have a historical awareness and how the harmonized system came into the being, and how it became adopted, and how it is managed at the international level. So the, to eliminate this, you really have to know the history and the adoption, the adoptional procedures of the United HTSUS pursuant to what's known as, again, HS Convention. Next, inaccuracies in the digits would never justify the rejection of an entry summary by customs import specialist. Well, we all know that the primary purpose of customs and border protection is to one of the, they have dual purpose, at least this is the, in their open statement, is to secure nation borders, such as protection against terrorism, and also to protect the revenue of the United States. So it's kind of like a twin goals of the customs mandate. Here we see that, we know that 10th, 9th and 10th digits, they do not really affect the duty rate of the product. So hence you may reason, if it doesn't affect the duty rate, who cares, right? Well, customs does not share this type of view, and they say that everything must be classified accurately, and because they, for example, the Congress bothered to adopt the distinction between pillowcases and sheets, as in this example, then probably it is important. If not for statistical purposes, then perhaps for the purposes of economic policy. So, for customs, no getting this right. If you bring sheets in, do not do this as pillowcases, because if you have a discrepancy, the import specialist in customs may reject, may provide you with a rejection. By the way, throughout the customs exam, you also you will see the reference to customs import specialist. And the reference to customs import specialist really refers to the gradation of the position within various positions that are held within customs and border protection. And usually when you clear customs, it will be done at the port, whatever port it be. So here in New York, we have JFK Airport, and we go to the port and we submit something. And when it is submitted, it is usually received by someone called entry specialist. Entry specialist. The import specialist is a little bit a higher position. Import specialist. It refers to the CBP officer who usually deals with either higher dollar amount or more complex commodities. Notice the united theme among them. All of them refer to something called specialists. This is because the agency, as a general rule, they like to have specialists on their staff which specialize in knowledge of the certain commodity or group of commodities. So we have, if you become a customs import specialist, you will be assigned, for example, to chemical products. If you have a chemical background, you are more likely to be assigned to that group, and this is what you will specialize in. That is not to say you will not be involved in other matters, you may, but most of your daytime will be spent analyzing chemical compounds, chemical products, products of various allied industries, and otherwise dealing with the chemical mix. Same goes, for example, for IT people. IT people who specialize in machinery, in computers, in technology, they also have their own unique niche, and they will specialize whether at the entry level or import level at those commodities. So inaccuracies would justify the rejection, because if it's inaccurate, it's not acceptable, And it is not acceptable because it doesn't fit the harmonized tariff schedule of the United States, irrespective of the revenue function. Now, we have what I think it's worth to take a little pause and mention a few words about the structure of the outline, the structure of the textbook, which deals with the format of capitalized letters, the small capitalized letters, and just a general text with underlines. The way it is structured, all of the text which you will see, is you have the main idea, which is usually the title, which is going to be in all caps. Everything will be capitalized. Usually, after the all caps provision, you will get the citation, because I rarely make things up, if at all. I may fill in a few gaps here and there when there is no clear position, but even then, I will defer to the legal precedents, not, for example, in the regulation, but in things such as judicial decisions by courts or administrative decisions by customs. So here, I'm not doing that. I'm just saying, okay, this comes from this law. And the law here, of course, we're dealing with Code of Federal Regulations. And here it will be Title 19 CFR one section. This is section, the symbol. 15211. Of course, this little portion of the number is called a part. And this one is called a section. Because a section would not be helpful, no, any section would not be helpful with part, I refer to the whole thing as a section. And then, usually the case is we have general rules and we have exceptions. So, general rule is helpful because you generally know that whatever you see over here is generally applicable. And then, the way most of the law works, in customs is not an exception, is you have bunch of exceptions. They are sometimes explicit, where they are just neatly written. Sometimes they are implicit by virtue of administrative decision or the judicial decision. So, general rule for the harmonized tariff schedule, if you bring it in, generally speaking, you must assign a number. You must assign a 10-digit number. You must classify it. But there are exceptions, and we shall later see. But let's take a look. So you bring it into the country, you must classify it. Can you do it on your own, or should you go to someone else and ask, please do this for me? Well, there is no clear answer. Really, since early 90s, I believe it's 1993, there was a law adopted by Congress under the auspices of Modernization Act. I believe it was Customs and Modernization Act. It was a bigger scheme under the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement. And the rule simply shifted the burden and say, it's importer who is responsible for the classification. If importer is incorrect in classifying, and they may be subject to penalties, they are liable for the incorrect action taken. So, what do we do, right? So, we, as licensed customs broker, well, importer is responsible for classification, that's true, but why is it that the customs broker exam is such a huge part of this whole endeavor? The one of the pillars, as I mentioned, is knowing how to navigate through the HTSUS. One reason is because licensed customs brokers, they are what the title says, a broker. A broker is really the person who is responsible for making, representing someone. They, in other words, they are brokering the activities of a party, such as importer in that case. So importer comes to the broker and says, broker, help me out. I am very good in computers, but I suck at classification. And because Modernization Act of 1993 shifted the responsibility on us, we are not good with this, can you help us out? So in other words, broker equals consultant, they really help out with clearance. And another huge part of the customs brokerage functions of the licensed customs broker is to assist with classification, hence the duty, hence the origin, and other compliances. Bless you. So, but sometimes the question may be difficult. Sometimes the question may be way too difficult for the broker or the sophisticated importer to really figure it out. In this situation, the private community, the private international trade community, importing community, can turn to government bodies.